Medicine and was the co-creator and regularly teaches a series of courses for students here to attain personal training certification. Walter also teaches classes on exercise physiology, sports nutrition, exercise program design, basketball, plyometrics, and many other courses. Table tennis. Don't call the ping pong. I've learned that. Walter plays NCAA Division III basketball, and in the 90s, he competed in professional triathlons. And he still gets out there from time to time as an amateur competition. Currently, Walter is also our faculty board member, and for the foundation, he has generously agreed to donate his $200 honorarium that he would get for this talk tonight back to the foundation to support the students here at the college. So thank you so much to Walter for doing that. And he's also a husband and a father, so we truly appreciate his time this evening. So please welcome Dr. Walter Morse.
Thank you, Nancy. And thank you to the foundation for sponsoring the speaker series and asking me to give this talk. I'm really happy to be here. This is something I love talking about. I have from looking around the audience and seeing some familiar faces, I have this sinking suspicion that I'm preaching to the choir, though. So, you know how people tend to watch the TV channels that confirm their existing points of view, especially with news and so forth? Well, I have a feeling this might be happening, but so my question that I'm asking myself is, how can I create value for people who already, spoiler alert, know the answer to the question on the board there? Yes, the answer is yes. So for those of you who are already convinced and appreciate the value of exercise, how can I create some value for you? So my hope is that I'll give a little bit of information about some of the science that's, I think, quite compelling about the magnitude of the impact of regular physical activity on a myriad of health outcomes. And just really the, I think, staggering, stunning, I'm going to say compelling evidence of how bad an unforced error. Who plays tennis? Anybody play tennis? Unforced error. They didn't hit a winner, but you made a mistake. It was your own, own error, even though there wasn't a high pressure shot at you. Like you could have done better. The unforced error of not moving enough has just a tremendous impact on our overall health as a world and a tremendous financial impact. So that's one thing that I hopefully will present. Secondly, I'll at least address the question of exercise, how much to do, how to do it to get a good return on health outcomes, and how effective, if at all, is exercise at managing body weight. So, I want to, first of all, aside from thanking the foundation, thank the American College of Sports Medicine. They've developed a worldwide initiative called Exercise is Medicine. I've borrowed their idea with permission and, of course, attribution here. But they've got a worldwide initiative dedicated to helping physicians and worldwide health leaders and advocates convey, deliver effective exercise programs to reap some of the benefits that I'll be alluding to. So, as I mentioned, a couple things I'll talk about is what are the costs of physical inactivity? I'll give a couple examples of studies demonstrating the effectiveness of exercise as compared side by side with pharmaceutical medical treatments. Talk a little bit about how much exercise is needed to get some of the health benefits, and then, as I mentioned, address the issue of exercise as a weight management tool. So this relatively recent journal of the issue of The Lancet succinctly outlines the problem. Physical inactivity really is in view of the prevalence, global reach, and health effect of physical inactivity, the issue should be appropriately described as pandemic, with far-reaching health, economic, environmental, and social consequences. And they put forth quite comprehensive arguments to that effect. This slide illustrates, and I know it's a little small for where you're sitting, but the top bar shows deaths attributed to the 19 leading risk factors. And you can see the first one is high blood pressure, tobacco use, high blood glucose, and number four is physical inactivity. So when you think of the various health problems that we face, physical inactivity independently ranks fourth as a global precursor or global factor associated with death. And of the leading causes of death in the US, the 15 leading causes in 2013, you can see those in red, heart disease number one, cancer number two, cerebrovascular diseases such as stroke number four, diabetes 7, and high blood pressure, along with renal disease number 13. Quite astounding how critical physical inactivity is in impacting these leading causes of death. To illustrate the impact of physical activity on risk of mortality, you can track the relationship between cardiorespiratory fitness and mortality. So this chart shows age-adjusted death rate per 1,000 people per year in low, moderate, and high levels of cardiorespiratory fitness. The dark bars are women, the light bars men, and you can see that the low-fit cardiorespiratory fitness category has roughly five times the high fit level, well, four times for men, 4.5 times for men, and about 3 times the incidence of death per year as compared to the high fit men. Again, attributable fraction of all-cause deaths, if you stack up low cardiorespiratory fitness, so low levels of aerobic fitness, compared to other leading causes of death, such as that are, I think, widely publicized and often thought of as the most significant primary causes of premature death, you can see that obesity, smoking, hypertension, high cholesterol, diabetes, each of them causes a lower percentage of deaths per year than low cardiorespiratory fitness. One study, a large study with about 1,000 women and men, 65 years or older with coronary artery disease, they were followed for 9 years. There were fitness tests done at baseline and 3 years later. And they looked at the change in calories burned per week over that 3-year span and then saw and identified a link between either increasing or decreasing physical activity and assessing the rate, essentially the likelihood compared to the baseline, which was 1 or 0, it's on the horizontal axis, of death. And you can see an extra 1,000 calories per week knocks the, let's see if I can make the pointer work here. Whoops.
The red line.
Am I, where am I? I'm not. Oh, I gotta hold it? Oh, there we go. Gotta hold the button. All right. So here we go. Thank you, Jeff. So if you draw the line up from the 1,000 calorie per week mark up to the curve here, you can see that you're essentially dropping risk of death by about 20% if you're increasing energy expenditure by about 1,000 calories per week. So to put that in perspective, walking for an average-sized person is probably going to be about, depending on the speed, 200 to 350 calories per hour. So you're talking about maybe 3 hours per week of walking to burn that, 3 or 4 hours per week of walking to burn that 1,000 calories. And that amount of physical activity is associated with a 20% reduction in risk of death. So additional illustrations of the point, another large study, also with about 1,300 total people, 3,000 women, 10,000 men, and you can see that, you know, again, the studies duplicate. And this, I guess I should make a point, as a person who teaches science, it's pretty easy to cherry pick the science. It's pretty easy to cherry pick science to make a point. And as a lifelong proponent of exercise and fitness, I have to, you know, work hard to be an impartial arbiter of this information. But I will say that I'm taking most of these slides from the American College of Sports Medicine Data Bank, and they're fair-minded physicians for the most part who do have an interest in exercise but are excited about conveying essentially the magnitude of the effect of exercise on reducing risk of death. This slide, again, illustrates by body weight category the impact of low, moderate, or high fitness on risk of death. So the 18.5 to 25 BMI, that's the normal body weight individuals, those with the lowest fitness had over a 4 times greater risk of dying than those of high fitness. In the overweight but not obese category, the trend persists. And then in the obese category, you can actually see that being obese but moderately or high fit confers a lower risk of premature death than being normal weight but low fit. So essentially this shows you that being fat and fit is better from a death risk perspective than being unfit and unfat. Elegantly expressed, I know. So here we go. Better stated this way. And then again, one more slide on this point. This shows fitness and mortality among non-communicable disease patients. And this one breaks down fitness by METs achieved in a fitness test. So METs, if you've ever seen them on your treadmill or your elliptical cross trainer, you press a button and the METs flash up on the screen. And what that reflects is a multiple of your resting metabolism. So right now you're all sitting, so you're burning 1 MET. You're burning 1 times your resting metabolic rate. As people start to exercise, that level of activity multiplies quickly. It's measured directly with the machine that measures how much oxygen you're using, and that will enable you to determine, if you're in a physiology lab anyway, what multiple. Are you working at 4 times your resting rate, 5 times, 7 times, 10 times? World-class distance runners can actually run a marathon at about 25 times their resting rate of oxygen use. So 25 METs can be sustained for about 2 hours by some of the best distance runners in the world. This broke down the participants into those who could, on an exercise test, either produce the red bars were less than 5 times their resting metabolic rate of energy expenditure and corresponding oxygen burning. The blue was 5 to 8, and the green is greater than 8 METs. So you can see that there's a direct relationship for each of the different other risk factors layered in with fitness as measured by how many multiples of their resting metabolism can they work at on an exercise test. You can see the trend holds true for individuals with a variety of other health problems. And again, another one, a very large study with older folks, 60 years or older, who 989 of whom died during the 14-year follow-up study, 25% were women. After adjusting for other factors, the low, moderate, and high fitness levels and the corresponding rate of death is indicated in the chart. And you can see that among 80-plus-year-old individuals, the death rate for those high fit level was lower than, and this will maybe a little bit of an anomaly, that it's actually even lower than the high fit 60 to 69 year olds. But at least you can see by comparison to, for example, the low fit 60 to 69 year old cohort, that death rate was about double that of the fit, of the high fit 80 plus year olds during a 1 year snapshot. All right. So I promised I'd talk a little bit about the comparative effects of exercise and common medical interventions. And we'll just look at a couple types of non-communicable health problems. And there are many more. We could also talk about arthritis. We talk about various autoimmune diseases. There are lots of different examples where exercise can be quite helpful. But if we look at a few of these, we'll look at diabetes, for example. About 7% of the U.S. population has diabetes. It's growing at a very fast rate. 90% of the cases of diabetes are type 2, which is adult onset, not necessarily genetically determined insulin dependent, but typically there's a significant lifestyle factor associated with type 2 diabetes. And so about 90% of those are type 2 diabetes. And to give an example of a study that illustrates the potency of exercise, there was a greater reduction, almost double the reduction, in the incidence of diabetes as measured by blood sugar levels and necessity to take medicine to combat it for those who took the physical activity intervention as compared to those taking the most common diabetes medicine. With depression, one study cited here indicated a 57% reduction in depression as measured by a commonly used depression index. And they found in this study a dose-response relationship. They had multiple exercise amount groups, and those who did the most exercise got the biggest reduction, the biggest impact on improving depression. And to be fair, this is a, you know, there are many, many studies that have looked at this, and a typical result is for exercise to be about on par with Prozac or other antidepressant medications, and also cognitive and other counseling sorts of interventions work about the same. So exercise, for many, many studies, not all, this one showed quite a dramatic effect of exercise for the high exercise level participants. But for many studies, exercise works about as well as selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors like Prozac and other depression medications. For bone health, about 10 million individuals have osteoporosis in the US, and about nearly 40 million are at risk in terms of having essentially bone densities that are on the border or make them susceptible to osteoporosis. And one study to illustrate the impact of exercise, now granted this is a relatively high amount of exercise, it's a large cohort, several thousand participants in this study, and those taking hormone medicine had about a two-third reduction in hip fracture risk, and that was about the same impact as those in the highest quartile of exercise group. So those who did the most exercise got about the same two-thirds reduction in risk of hip fracture over the span that was being addressed. While I'm on the topic of bone health, when I talk about exercise and I'm giving a similar sales pitch to my students and others on exercise, I talk about some things need to get all of us. Eventually, none of us get out alive, right? So something's going to get us. So the question is, are there things that we can build a bigger buffer against? Are there things that if we take some action, we can essentially make something, that's not the thing that's going to get us. So osteoporosis, fractures. One of the problems with hip fractures is there's about a 15 to 20% death rate for people over 75 who have a hip fracture within the year after that hip fracture. It's an extremely debilitating and serious problem. And so this is something that all of us, actually all individuals lose, maybe not you because many of you are very physically active and you may be stressing your bones enough to preserve some of your bone density, but for the vast majority of us, we lose about 0.5% of our bone density per year after the age of 40. So some doctors and exercise scientists think of this challenge of preserving bone density, building up bone density so that that's not the thing that gets us, as something to try to take advantage of when we're young, like in your first 30 or 40 years of life, when you have a greater capacity to work your muscles and stress your bones. Maybe you can build your bones up, build the bone density higher to create a bigger buffer, so that's not the thing that gets you. So to that end, I'm a big proponent of resistance exercise and other exercises that load the bones enough to stress them. So walking, if you're stuck in outer space as an astronaut, walking is helpful. It's enough of a stress to promote bone density. But for all of us who walk already, it's not enough. It's gotta be something more than what we're used to. The term in exercise science is we have to overload or do more than what we're accustomed to create adaptations and change. So exercises such as running and resistance training that provide that overload, that extra stress, is what's quite helpful. And if you look at the literature and study different sorts of athletes and the various bone density levels they have, not surprisingly, gymnasts, runners, weightlifters, bodybuilders, they have the highest bone densities. As you go through other activities, basketball, soccer, still good bone density, but not as good as, say, bodybuilders or shot putters. Then as you go down, swimmers are about the same as sedentary control. So there's not enough stress on the bones from swimming for that to be very effective at promoting bone density improvements. So, but the point is, and if you look closer at some of the literature, you can actually see a correlation between strength and bone density. So stronger athletes, stronger individuals, as assessed by how much weight they can press with their arms or their legs, tend to have denser, thicker bones, and therefore a lower risk of osteoporosis. So tons lifted per year. Track your tons per year and see how you stand up. Cancer. I'll talk about a couple types of cancer. Colon cancer first. The data is really compelling with high levels of physical activity as reducing tumorigenesis for colon cancer in particular. It's, I think, remarkable. The impact is also quite strong with breast cancer, not as big as with colon, but still quite an impact on reducing risk of breast cancer incidence. All right, I'm gonna shift gears and talk a little bit about, I'm guessing people have questions, so I'm just gonna plow forward and then we'll take as much time as we need to answer questions if there are any questions later. But as far as the next topic, I'm gonna talk a little bit about the impact of physical activity on weight management. So there are a few categories. One category is for people who are obese or overweight and wanna lose weight. So about two-thirds of Americans are either obese or overweight. About one-third of us are classified as overweight, and about one-third normal weight, and about one-third obese. The way this is tracked is the Center for Disease Control gets data statewide and nationally, enough data to characterize the population. And they do simply a ratio between body weight and height. There's a little bit of a formula with some math involved, but the essential thing is it's a ratio between weight and height. And so you may think, well, I mean, I can think of a bodybuilder or a professional football running back who, if you do the math, they'll misclassify as obese even though they're not obese. So it's possible to misclassify someone on a weight to height ratio if they're heavily muscled. But fortunately, the CDC kind of has, that's a small enough segment of the population that the data as a whole makes sense, so they can paint a fairly accurate picture of the prevalence of overweight and obesity. And it's somewhat stabilized over the last few years. At least the rate of increase of overweight and obesity in the U.S. has decreased to the point where it's not ratcheting up quickly. If you want to see something scary, you can type in obesity trends CDC PowerPoint slideshow. It'll show you the progression, the incidence of, on a state-by-state basis, of overweight and obesity actually, over the last 25 years, and it's just remarkable the rate in which it's increased. But the rate of growth has stabilized to some degree, although the rest of the industrialized world is catching up. And so, essentially, we're looking at about two-thirds of Americans who are either overweight or obese, and many of them want to lose weight. So if they just exercise, if they just start doing aerobics, just start doing jogging, or bike riding, or cross-country skiing, or some sort of aerobic-type activity on a regular basis, what kind of results can they expect? Well, the American College of Sports Medicine convened a panel of experts to look at this, and to look at all the data, especially the controlled science on the topic, where they really track people carefully. And for those who are doing about 150 minutes, so let's say 3 times 50 minutes per week, or 4 times 40 minutes-ish per week of aerobic exercise, really no effect. No effect on body weight. None. Does this surprise anybody? Maybe a little, but it's not earth-shattering. It's not like an epiphany here. What about those who did, let's say, almost, so 240 minutes would be 4 hours, so a little less than 4 hours per week. So now they're doing 5 times 45 minutes per week. Over a period of 6 months to a year, done diligently, they might lose 5 pounds, maybe 5 pounds with that level of effort. That's pretty diligent. And then for those who, and we're talking about, again, if you're looking at overweight and obese, you're looking at, you know, overweight, you could be 20 pounds overweight, obese, a person could be 70, 80 or more pounds overweight. And they're really looking at 100 pounds overweight, and you're looking at a year of 6 hours per week and maybe losing 12 or 15 pounds. So it's kind of a small, I'm gonna say it's not a potent tool. It's done alone. If exercise is done alone, it's not that. It's great for combating the diseases. It's great for not dying from a lot of the other causes we talked about a moment ago. But it's not that effective for weight loss if it's the only tool in your toolkit. What about for maintaining weight loss? Let's say you exercised and cut back on calories and lost 30 pounds over 6 months, and now you want to keep that weight loss off. You don't want it to creep back. How much exercise do you need to keep the weight loss that you achieved? It's a lot. It's not a small amount. And so a good example of this outcome is if you look at the literature on pretty aggressive diets that usually they're medically supervised, typically they're 800 to 1,000 calories. Usually they're done with people who are over 50 pounds overweight. They're done for 6 months, 8 months, 9 months. Typical weight loss could be 60, 70, 80 pounds, right? Then they try to maintain. And they separate the groups into those who are closely monitored to where they make sure they're exercising nearly an hour a day, and those who are not exercising an hour a day. And they check up on them either a year later or 2 years later. No matter what the dietary approach employed to achieve the, say, 60-pound weight loss, those who did not religiously exercise an hour a day after having achieved that weight loss universally regained it. So exercise, although it's not necessarily potent at initial weight loss, it is essential for maintenance of weight loss once the person has achieved that weight loss through some combination of diet and exercise. So, and this holds true especially for those with either the genetic or the lifestyle factors that led them to become substantially overweight. So if people become substantially overweight and they put in the effort to lose the weight through diet and exercise, I'm recommending both, to have a fighting chance of keeping that hard-earned weight loss in place, they've got to exercise an hour a day. It's just that's what the science unequivocally indicates. Pretty happy to hear that, right? What about exercise and prevention of initial weight gain? So for those who are at their normal weight or at some reasonable weight, and they want to stay there, and they want to use exercise to combat weight gain in the first place. Again, it's not a small amount that's needed. It works. 200 minutes, 150 to 250 minutes per week of physical activity is enough to prevent more than 3% of body weight gain. So it works. It's just, once again, it's work. For those of you who enjoy it, for those of you who found an activity you really like, more power to you, that's great. That's an enormous part of the ballgame. But it's a substantial amount of investment to prevent weight loss, sorry, to prevent weight regain, to prevent weight gain, to preserve weight loss. And then it needs to essentially be combined with caloric restriction to achieve substantial weight loss. And I'll say to achieve weight loss in a time course that's motivating, that's reinforcing, that makes people feel like they're getting somewhere. So exercise alone, it works, to some degree, but it may not work enough for people to see the results quickly enough to get the motivation to want to stick with it. All right, I'm gonna talk for a minute or two about walking speed and kind of circle back to the theme of something's gonna get us. And if we're trying to outwalk the Grim Reaper, we gotta walk at least how fast? Faster than him. Okay. So here's the thing: walking speed is important. So as we get older, if we can preserve walking speed, we can live longer. It turns out that if you're looking at people over 70 years old, The This is in meters per second because science is in meters. But you really need to walk at least, if you walk 2 miles an hour, the Grim Reaper is going to get you. For 3 miles an hour, you're in the clear. So preserving decent walking speed is really critical for staying alive. It's also important to stay strong enough to get off the toilet seat. So again, to summarize a few of the key points for exercise as medicine, I don't know if you can read these, but it reduces the risk of heart disease. Regular physical activity reduces the risk of heart disease by 40%, lowers risk of stroke by 27%, cuts incidence of diabetes by about half, reduces the incidence of high blood pressure by almost 50%, can reduce mortality and recurrent risk of breast cancer by almost 50%, can lower the risk of, you know, different research, this is another study that had 60%, originally I cited 50%, I think 50% is fair, can reduce the risk of developing Alzheimer's disease, and can be an effective antidepressant. So the benefits are overwhelming, they're clear cut, the magnitude is huge. And as far as the guidelines for physical activity by the government and by the American College of Sports Medicine, so this is where it gets tricky. Nobody really knows exactly how much to do. When I first started doing personal training, before personal training was really a big thing about 25 years ago, the American College of Sports Medicine had some really specific guidelines on exercise intensity. It needs to be 67 to 83% of your heart rate reserve or your VO2 max. You need to go at least 30 minutes, 4 times per week. It was all precise and detailed, and you could do target heart rate calculations using the carbonin formula that took into account your resting heart rate. And I used to actually recommend these specific things, say 4 times per week at this level, and my clients wouldn't do it. They would only work out when I was there. And I was wondering, what's going on here? After thinking about it for a while, I don't know if this is true or not, but my speculation was that it's kind of like if you tell someone you need to do something 3 times per week, and it's Monday, are they going to do it? No, they got 6 more days to do those 3 times, right? Then Tuesday comes. You still have, what, 5? No problem. And then what happens on Thursday? Oh, I gotta do this, or I gotta do that, or something comes up. And so the point is, I found that I started just not ignoring the frequency recommendations, but telling people that they had to do something every day. I would tell them that it's, think of it like brushing your teeth when you're tired and you're ready to go to bed, you don't really wanna do it. Do you do it anyway? Yeah, you do it. You just do it. It's part of it. It's a habit you've established. So if you can establish a habit of going for a walk, of doing some sort of physical activity that you like every single day, I think that's the ball game. I think doing it to it so it's not requiring willpower. It's not requiring effort to schedule. It's something that you just simply develop as a habit. Is really, really valuable. And so I used to tell, after a while, I'd tell people to do something every day, and they would stick with it better. I mean, nobody was perfect, of course, but they would stick with it better than the 3 or 4 times at some set level. Now, the American College of Sports Medicine and other governmental agencies have completely, and I mean completely, given up on precise, intensity-based exercise recommendations. So they used to say, you have to exercise at this certain percentage of your maximal heart rate or your VO2 max. Now it's 2 categories, moderate or vigorous. And moderate for one person is different than moderate for somebody else. And vigorous for one person is different than vigorous for someone else. So it's a little bit of a subjective, open to interpretation. You kind of have to just use your judgment in a way as far as how hard you're pushing yourself. But if you opt for the moderate, for someone who's reasonably fit but not super fit, imagine brisk walking or light jogging. Right on that moderate level of activity, for that level, it's the recommendation according to the governmental and other agencies is 150 minutes per week or more of moderate physical activity. Now, for some people, that might just mean normal walking, not even brisk walking. It might mean, you know, doing some chores around the house, just some physical activity that you're moving. The individual by individual aspect can't be emphasized enough. But if it's vigorous, now that might mean jogging at a faster pace, or working on a stationary bicycle and exercising a little bit harder, or playing soccer, or some sort of more vigorous level of physical activity. And that might, for that category, the recommendation now is 75 minutes or more per week. And when I say the 150 minutes of moderate or the 75 minutes of vigorous, that's the expert identified amount necessary to reap the health benefits to combat the various diseases that are associated with inactivity. So that's to avoid the unforced error of inactivity, essentially. That's your threshold. Now, what else should people do? Well, strength training is really valuable. It's critical for bone density preservation. Strength tracks with bone density, and strength tracks with preservation of functional activity and the ability to do various things over the course of one's life. So strength is valuable. It also helps reduce the risk of diabetes, make diabetes less severe for those who have it. So strength training is quite important. And two times per week of major body area exercises, bench presses and pulls and squats or pushes on a leg press machine, those sorts of things are the most effective because they involve large muscle groups. Those are really valuable. And it's amazing how little time one needs to invest in those sorts of activities to reap the benefits. So resistance training is really good. Those are the two most important categories. Stretching is helpful. Balance training is helpful. Finding sports or activities that one likes. I do teach ping pong. People are sometimes a little bit particular about that. I don't mind being a PE teacher who teaches ping pong. I can live with that. So those are some of the take-home messages in terms of the amount to do. And so if you really look at some of these different types of health problems, non-communicable diseases that exercise dramatically impacts the incidence and severity of. So you can't skip the exercise. And so what really amazes me is how exercise favorably impacts so many different health problems. I want to thank the foundation, the American College of Sports Medicine, and Dr. Adrian Hepburn, who's the Vice President of Exercises Medicine, the worldwide campaign to sell this message. Thank you. That's the stuff that was handy on the ACSM, Exercises Medicine, you know, the resources. But there's a growing body for each of these different non-communicable diseases. And when I talk about this, the best I can say is that's just a coincidence. There's no message behind that. Yes.
So probably when I look around too, I would say you're talking to the people who are doing it. I guess the other end of it, if you're a crazy exerciser, what's too much?
No, that's a great question. I don't think the scientists know. I don't think they know. I don't think they've spent enough time. It's also very difficult to study. The individuals who do a marathon every month, or Ironman triathlons year after year after year, decade after decade. As a person who's looked at the literature, I'll speculate that there is a point of diminishing returns, and there is a point of no additional returns, where more, if not, it's not better, it might be worse. I don't know if there's a downward trend yet. I don't think scientists know that yet. There's a dose response, a favorable dose response, in the sense that more is better up to and through the points that have been studied. So up to about an hour a week of aerobic activity, more is better. An hour a day. I don't know if more than 7 hours per week, I don't know if 10 hours per week is better than 7, and I don't know if 15 is too much and now I'm getting some risk of health problems. That's a really interesting question, which I think really merits scientific scrutiny, but to my knowledge, the research isn't there yet.
We are seeing professional bike riders having a ton of fractures, all kinds of things going wrong with their bodies because they're not doing any weight-specific stuff. We're also seeing marathon runners in the hospital who have really screwy cardiac enzyme stuff going on. So it seems to me that there must be, I know that's not what you're talking about, but there must be a level of too much.
I'll agree with that. I won't push back on that. I'll also, to build on your point, the immunology research that looks at, for example, incidence of upper respiratory tract infections, common colds, no exercise is a little worse than moderately intense exercise in terms of immune function. So moderately intense exercise done regularly, visualized 45 minutes to an hour, 5 or 6 days a week, 70% of your capacity to push yourself. So moderately intense done regularly actually temporarily augments markers of immune function. So moderate exercise is good for our immune system, better than being sedentary. Very high levels temporarily depress immune function. So people who do marathons are at a markedly greater risk of upper respiratory tract infections in the first 2 weeks after having finished their marathon compared to either running but non-marathon running controls or sedentary controls. So there is at least, that's a good one example of your point. Now to your other point, extreme exercise is risky, whether it's bike racing or skiing or anything done, high altitude mountaineering. People do extreme levels of sports not for their health. And I think I don't think they're thinking that they're doing it for their health in most cases, those who really go to the extreme.
I have a question. So we live in a mountain community. I'm curious about we're talking about bone density, now swimming's not very good for that, so I'm curious about skiing. So if you're out skiing a lot, not just cruising the groomers, but you're working, you're going through trees, you're making a lot of turns, where does that fit on your fitness schedule? I always feel like I'm trying to count that as a workout or two, and I want to know how if I can.
No cheat. If you're jumping and landing and not crashing, it's very good for your bones. That's good for your bones. If you picture professional skiers and the amount of pressure they put on their muscles and bones while negotiating turns at high speeds, it's enormous. I won't say it's the same as jumping on and off a box, but it's in the ballpark of heavy levels of force on the bones, and that's the sort of stress that stimulates the bones to get stronger. So stress, and so doing a squat with a weight on the bar and squatting down and squatting back up is great for improving bone density because it stresses the muscles that attach to the bones, it stresses the spine at the same time, and as long as it's done in a progressive and, with good technique and so forth within one's capacity, it's very, very helpful for a lot of the benefits, the bone density, the strength, and others. And I can visualize a good skier making lots of hard turns, actually getting some of that squatting effect. So I'll buy into that. The question is, are you doing enough runs and enough turns for it really to add up? Probably yes. If you're just skiing for an hour or two, maybe. Who knows if you're doing enough? I don't know. But something is better than nothing, and that sort of loading would be helpful.
Okay. Yes.
So once you get out of the meat property, as a page or whatever, what kind of data status can help you to stay strong?
So that's a great question. It depends on what, you know, access to facilities and so forth you have. So swimming is very good from a cardiovascular fitness point of view. It's very good from a, you know, toning and preservation of flexibility and range of motion. So swimming is good from an aerobic standpoint, and it's not stressful to the joints, to the knees in particular. It's not great for bone density. So, I mean, I think if the person can walk, walking is great, because walking confers a lot of advantages, and as you know, working diligently to keep your walking speed is a winning strategy. But beyond that, resistance training with good guidance, a person with various joint problems, whether it's knee, back, shoulder, hip, elbow, whatever it might be, a good personal trainer, a good physical educator, can help that person find exercises that can be done that don't bother the affected areas, or the exercises can be modified in terms of the range of motion in order to get the benefit of loading the muscles, loading the bones, building the muscle strength, getting the corresponding improved ability to manage blood sugar, reduce the risk of diabetes, manage diabetes if you have it. All these things can be achieved with good guidance, but it's going to take the right place. One of those right places are on campus fitness center here. So we do have a really good, actually a free program. It's technically for older adults. We don't have a specific age cutoff, but it involves a combination of cardiovascular, balance, resistance training, flexibility. For those who are at more some lower starting points or have various joint problems, they do exercises where you're sitting in a chair and progress to other activities, and it's guided by our physical education staff. It meets Monday through Friday, the different sections do. It's free. My colleague Tim Johnson developed it and figured out a way to get it so the state essentially funds it, and I encourage you to check it out if you're interested in getting some good guidance or take advantage. Again, we have some really good instructors that are on campus programming.
The 150 minutes, of course, we've broken it down to smaller chunks, say 30 minutes, five times a week. And I believe I've heard that when you break that down further, it still kind of counts. So how small is...
I was
too
expecting,
small.
I know, I was expecting that question.
I figured it probably...
No, I was expecting that question, and that the answer, to my knowledge, has not been definitively spelled out in the literature, but it's currently being examined, and there's some preliminary indication that small chunks are helpful. Now, whether or not small bursts of activity are as useful in getting the health benefits as those 10-minute or longer chunks remains to be seen, but small bursts is unequivocally better than nothing, and possibly as good as the longer stretches.
So you're even, 3 tens are reasonable.
3 tens are fine, 3 tens are fine, and possibly even smaller chunks might be valuable too. And I think that comment segues me to at least digress to one other topic on high intensity interval training, which HIIT or HIIT, thank you. So it's in vogue now, and it's an effective, time-efficient approach to get a lot of the cardiovascular fitness benefits that are associated with those longer, more continuous, moderately intense exercise bouts that go something like 30 to 50 to 60 minutes. Those are great, but the high-intensity stuff involves going very intensely for 30 seconds, for example, and then recovering for 90 seconds and doing that six times, or working up to being able to do that six times, and then calling it a day. And the research shows that people who do that, especially in the lab where the researchers are yelling at them to keep their intensity at maximal levels, get really good results on blood pressure management, cholesterol, triglyceride management, blood glucose level improvements. It's not as effective for combating overweight and obesity, but it's helpful. But for a lot of those other health correlates, it's quite effective. The problem is, it really hurts to go all out for 30 seconds, and so it's difficult to get compliance when the studies are done. It's difficult to get people to continue. But for those who like, there are some of us who actually would rather go really hard for 30 seconds six times than go continuously for 40. There's some people who prefer that. And if you prefer that, and if you can find a mode of activity that your body can tolerate, whether it's cross-country skiing or running if everything works, including your knees, or whether it's stationary biking or spinning, yeah, that can be quite effective and quite time efficient. One caveat on that is I wouldn't recommend doing that every day because it can be physically and psychologically taxing. And so doing it two or three times a week or building up to two or three times a week makes more sense to me for a high-intensity training as opposed to doing it every day. It can also be modified to do 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 minute long intervals. Those are really a psychological grind, but if you like to push yourself for 4 minutes hard, recover for 4 minutes, and do that 3 or 4 times, you can get similar benefits to those 30-second all-out bursts as an alternative to the steady, say, 30 to 60-minute aerobic bout. Yes?
Dr. Morris? I understand you have a very full history in that, but what do you do now?
this is my training partner, Michael Sharp, who I've been training with for years. I spend about 45 minutes, 4 times a week on a stationary bike in my garage watching taped basketball games. And I sometimes look at my heart rate monitor to keep myself honest, but not always. But I'll do more before I get back on the road with you, I promise. Yes?
Yeah, working on specific muscle groups, is there any advantage or disadvantage to using like free weights or a machine?
Yes, that's a great question. I think the advantage to free weights and why they're so popular is they require coordination, and if you're doing them standing, which is what most of my staff recommend for most individuals to do, when possible, do it standing if you're lifting weight over your head or if you're doing a squat. It requires postural control. It's ground-based, and so you're actually working against gravity, and you're having to control the implement in space, which provides a greater challenge and a more real-world-like challenge than, say, pushing on a track where it's completely scripted and your back is supported with a bench. So essentially it has the potential to translate better into doing something in real life, whether it's a sport or some physical activity. So if possible, free weights are preferred, provided you have the proper coaching to make sure your technique is good. Machines are great too as an introduction and as a way to do something with really minimal amount of supervision because they're safer, they're more controlled. So each has its advantage. But my staff, I've encouraged them to sell the free weights because they're able to pay close enough attention to make sure you're doing it correctly, and then you get some additional advantages from that that I think translate, the greater demands translate better. Any other questions? Thank you very much.